the September 4th, 2018 Duval City Council meeting to order. Would you please rise for the flag salute led by Mayor Pro Tem Matthew Beyer?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Clerk, would you please take the roll?
Councilmember Rudnicki.
Here.
Councilmember Iyer.
Here.
Councilmember McHenry.
Here.
Councilmember Bennington.
Here.
Councilmember Hogue.
Here.
Councilmember Nappland. Councilmember Walker. We have a quorum.
Thank you. Under additions or corrections to the agenda, under consent agenda, please add payroll for September 5th, 2018 in the amount of $113,365.22. And claims in the amount of $157,147.76. And please, under item number 4 on consent agenda, add to excuse the absence of Councilmember Jason Walker due to illness. Are there any council members that would like to speak this evening? Councilmember Hogue. All right, anyone else? Councilmember Remington. All right. Do we have a motion to adopt the council agenda?
So moved.
A second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Do we have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Item number 4, ratification of contracts under declaration of emergency. We do not have any this evening, so we will move on to item number 5, comments from the audience. Is there anyone in the audience that would like to speak this evening? Right. Please approach the podium and give your name and address, and you'll have 3 minutes to speak.
I'm Mike Carmona, 16409315, Duval, Washington. I'm here in the Chamber of Commerce, and we're going to share that we have our monthly meeting this Thursday. Anybody like to attend?
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak this evening? All right, seeing none, we'll move on to scheduled items. I have my report. First of all, we've declared September National Recovery Month for those that have been suffering from drug abuse addiction. It's been a kind of quiet week with a lot of the regional meetings being canceled, and I did take some personal time out with family. But I did want to share with folks that our interim public works director has started, Mr. Tim Hayden. So he's down at public works a couple of days a week working with staff and consultants down there. The police chief was very diligent in getting a couple of key policies that I've been asking for quite a while done and out to the council. So I'll pass these down, one of which was a definite necessary update to our anti-harassment policy, which now includes a section on bullying. And that, keep in mind that that applies to council as well, so if employees have an issue with folks, that's the policy that it abides by. And then we also put forth an anti-violence, workplace violence policy as well, and those are the first big steps towards getting our personnel policies done, and Chief Burt, as Deputy City Administrator, has taken on that role and has really stepped up to the plate in working, getting these things done through legal in a quick manner as well as through the union. So thank you, Chief, for moving all that forward. You've received an email today from Finance Director Duvon on the audit entrance conference. So if anybody would like to attend that, that's 9 a.m. this Friday. We were noticing it just in case that there was a quorum that wanted to attend, but please do let Lindsay know if you're going to be there so we can make sure there's enough chairs and materials. Next up, last week, Ms. Thomas and Chief Burt and I met with Janice Corbin of Sound Employment Solutions. She's going to be helping us with some of the work that's needed in the sewer treatment plant, and she also has an extensive history in Washington State with cities and others looking at workplace culture, job descriptions, making sure you're classifying things correctly and overall reorganization. So we are talking to her about receiving a scope of work to move forward with the citywide first ever reorganization and looking at job descriptions, looking at the jobs that people are actually doing, looking at what we need in the future, and looking at the wage scales to make sure we're aligned appropriately to attract staff. So with that, the last thing I have on my agenda this evening is, for those that haven't RSVP'd, tomorrow is the Sales and Use Association networking dinner. It will be in Bellevue, so there's still time to go if you would like to go and not have to drive to it. So with that, I have nothing further. Does anyone have any questions? Great, thank you. So next up will be Councilmember Hope.
So I attended the King County Flood Control District Advisory Committee. It was our fifth meeting that we had this year. I was there as a Sound Cities Association alternate, but I was really fortunate to be able to sit at the table and have a voice and a vote during these meetings. So we did submit a recommendation to the King County Flood Control District Board of Supervisors for the 2019 annual budget and the 2019 to 2024 six-year capital improvement project, improvement program. And I can forward this recommendation off to you so you can all get it. If anyone wants to help you, let me know. One of the things that was recommended, which I was pleased about, was the advisory committee discussed the status of King County's Napalmy Fish Farm Flood Committee recommendations, and we recommended that the district consider providing technical support to the work of the Front Fish Flood Implementation Steering Committee. In addition, we recommended that the district consider assigning the district executive director to participate in the quarterly Farm Fish Flood in implementation steering committee. So that was one of the items on the recommendations.
Thank you. Does anyone have any questions for Councilmember Hope? Right, seeing none, we'll move on to Councilmember Remington.
Thank you. I just want to take a moment to recognize our city staff. We've had so many changes this year, a new mayor, new council folks. We've had so many documents that we've tried to update, especially with getting ahead of growth and development in our area. We've got a two-year budget that we're leaning towards, and I just, all my communication with staff have really made it clear to me the amount of dedication that our folks have. Really good communication to myself and others on the council about what's going on, and the work that they're doing really is helping advance us. And I don't think, at least for me, I've stopped enough just to say thank you, both to our directors as well as our budget staff and so many of our departments. And I just ask that we have a chance to pass that along, if you will, for us, and let them know we appreciate all the changes that they've faced, and appreciate the dedication they have to our citizens and the work we have to do. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, moving on to administration.
So good evening, Mayor, Council, and members of our community. As we had said at our last meeting, we're going to be doing a brief administrative update every meeting and putting it to PowerPoint. That way our city clerk gets it and we can make sure that our public sees it as well. And so for the most part, we'll just continue to update, and there's always going to be something that we're going to be talking about. I think moving in the future, we're definitely busy internally and externally. So the first thing I wanted to talk about was just the public works director and where we're at. As the mayor said, Tim joined our forces last week, and we are definitely keeping him busy, although we are trying to shuffle people around because we don't have a lot of space. And so we have three people trying to occupy one space, so we're trying to do a little bit better coordination with that so that we're not all stepping over each other. We're continuing to work on the job description. That'll be complete this week. We also are currently working on separate contracts to assist with the Public Works Director's current job. So besides having Tim Hayden aboard, we also have a professional engineer through SDA and a building official that is through WC3. So I just want to always make sure that we remind ourselves that as we go without a Public Works Director, that we're paying three separate contract amounts. While some of it is full cost recovery, there is a large portion that's not. So starting at the next meeting, I'm going to start bringing a report on kind of where we're spending those dollars at, just so that we get a good idea, because it also will help incentivize us to recruit probably as quickly as possible, because it's costing us more to do that than it is to have a Public Works Director. We've completed a salary evaluation on multiple levels. We'll be talking about that here in just a second. We have obviously a staff level recommend that the salary be increased to market rate. But one of the things that I think Carrie and I acknowledged here last week is because we technically are still your directors, it does feel like a conflict of interest for us to be trying to promote a wage increase for a director that's normally modeled with us. And so we'll likely have a consultant come in and talk to you about the Public Works Director and salary compensation. But we're at least going to give you some of the information this evening that we'll then share with the consultant, and they can either use it or add on to it or subtract to it. Staff will bring forward a request for the ordinance essentially to change the salary at a forward reaching meeting. Of course, we'd like to see it at the next meeting, but it might not be completely matured by then, but we're hopeful. And at that meeting, we'll at least have, if not a person to come through and talk with you, a memo for the file for us to review with you. Once it's approved, we'll begin the recruitment for the Public Works Director. Again, we're likely going to do that internally because it'll save a significant amount of resources. When you go out through Kaufman, you pay them usually between $25,000 and $40,000 to do the recruitment. And then at the end of the 6 months, you go to 10% of their base on your salary. So it's a pretty expensive endeavor. So this was what we gave previously for salary comparison. And that was us looking at where did we think at a staff level our competition was. After that presentation, we did get some feedback from a couple of council members. And so we went back to the drawing board and re-looked at cities that were more like us in some ways, but unlike us in other ways. It really is not an easy process to really look at who are your comparisons, because no one city is alike. King County is more expensive than Snohomish County. The further north, the further south you go, your cost of living decreases, and obviously the further east you go, it's hard to compare cities of our size. Now I know why people pay for salary studies and stuff after doing this exercise. So what we did is we pulled in some additional information and comparison. So what we did is we looked at, okay, what is, what's their size? We also looked at the cost of living index, which is that third. So where you see that Woodinville is 190.9. So they are 190.9 of the average U.S. cost of living. So you can see all of our cities essentially are above that 100%. My guess is even if you went into Eastern Washington, you'd find them at or around 100% as well. We also looked at, okay, how many FTEs is the Public Works Director managing? Is there a comparison there? So in Duval, you can see the yellow curves or the blue line. Our existing Public Works Director, if they were here today, we'd manage about 19 employees. Is there a deputy? No. Are they the city engineer for us? Yes. But a lot of other cities have a city engineer or they already have a PE, so it just depends. We also looked at comparable, do they have longevity pay? Some of the communities do have longevity pay. Other cities have what they call performance-based bonuses. So we looked at that as well. We also looked to see what was the cost of medical for the employee and medical for the family. So we thought that those were some of the cities that would be somewhere comparable to ours. And then what we did is we kind of broke them down and again, throughout the high, throughout the low. And then when you take that and you put an average together, the average would be about 9306 on the starting rate wage to 11755. So it's essentially a change on the low end of about $500 a month, and on the higher end, about $1,100 a month. We also looked at, because we were asked this question, which I thought was great, is where were there new hires within the last year and a half, and did they have experience? So you can see Mapleteo, Mill Creek, and Mount Lake Terrace have hired within the last year and a half, and the ones with the stars had no director experience. So that means that they're probably coming from a smaller mid-sized city and jumping into a new job. So where the other thing we wanted to look at is, you know, where do all former public directors go to? And so we looked and did a windshield survey of where our past directors have gone, and that's Snohomish, Marysville, Sammamish, and Waffle. And three of the four went on to be public works directors within their field in those new cities, and one went to be an operations director within the public works department. And then just looking at kind of where we are. So they, you know, they've definitely moved, I guess I'll say, onward and upward from Duval. The wastewater treatment plant update. Our wastewater treatment plant manager met with us today along with their union representation. And our manager will be returning to work on September 8th under a PIP. And he will be managed by myself, the interim public works director, and likely an outside consultant. We have a contract that we're working on with Brian Osborne for services that will go to ratification at the next council meeting. We've been working with Parametrics so they can begin the capacity analysis. We'll do a check-in this week with the Department of Ecology to provide them an update. We have also offered a potential new employee. An offer of employment was extended last week, and right now we're beginning the background check. And that will be completed by the end of the week, and if all goes well, we'll be turning that in from a conditional offer to a full offer. Are there any questions? Any questions for Ms. Thomas?
Zena, thank you so much.
Thank you.
We do not have any presentations.
We have one more part to our... Thank you.
Sorry, I should have said that. Great, Ms. Thomas.
Update number two is what we're going to call this presentation for going over the levy. So again, just to cover the 2016 levy that was put out for a vote, was to cover the debt service for the Big Rock ball fields, a school resource officer, and IT system improvements. And the update that we wanted to provide that was different from the last council meeting is that the annual levy amount can increase by 1% of the assessed value plus new construction, which is not what we stated before. So that is the main correction. So with that, I'm giving you a couple different ways, and I handed out some Excel graphs that you can look at when we get to those. So originally we said that it was the $339,330 and increase that can be increased by 1%. And when you add the new construction for the levy, that increased it $9,698. The total new construction for the whole city, for the whole assessed value, was $49,500. And then going in to adding that created a add those two together from the 1% for the assessed value, property tax increase, and the new construction, the levy amount totaled $352,421.
And this was not demonstrated on your, in your budget documents. We put in the fixed amount of the $339,330 because that was the understanding that we had at that time. And we are going to bring that forward on a third quarter budget amendment to fix that and true it up to the $352,000. And this is going to be something that we are going to be able to get close to every single year, but we're probably going to have to bring it back on a first quarter amendment and true it up. And every single year, it does this, the amount that the 1%, that is optional on an act, on a vote. So when we, when I bring forward as part of the budget process and we talk about the 1% property tax increase, that's what we're referring to here on the assessed value, increasing that amount. But it does take council passing that, to be clear.
So if council didn't vote the 1% tax increase, say this year or next year, then it would not, that would not apply.
Then the new dollar amount of the $352,000 would not grow by an additional 1%. So this is directly from King County's website. This is the 2018 cities and towns. So I just wanted to show that in 2017, going into that levy rate, we posted as one of the flyers that we, that I additionally passed out, that was communicated to the community that that levy rate was gonna be at 0.325. And with the additional increase for the assessed value and new construction, you can see that that levy rate actually did decrease. And I wanted to show you on the, from King County's website, that the 352,421 is there within the city of Duval. And that is a variable rate. The levy rate is a variable rate from year to year. And as the assessed value continues to go up, for the city as a whole, the levy rate will continue to drop, as you've seen here, and vice versa. So if assessed values go down, then the levy rate will increase. So this is the handout that, oh, it actually shows pretty well up here. So in, on, to go over this, essentially we have the numbers for 2017, and we have the number for 2018. And then as we get this number every single year, once we have the exact amount, I think that we've decided that we will just be completely transparent and send out this, like an updated spreadsheet every single year. So this is showing actually a 1% increase of the assessed value and being very conservative. This is a very conservative approach. And this is adding absolutely no new construction, which is a variable amount anyway. So I wanted to give you a couple of options of very conservative and then probably more realistic. But as you can see, you have your annual debt obligation for the Big Rock ball field. With the increase, you take out the annual debt. The remaining dollars are to fund the school resource officer. And we believe that we have projected the school resource officer very conservatively on for the true projected costs, and then the remaining dollars would then be allocated to the IT system improvements, as was stated. What we believe to be probably a more realistic approach would create two assumptions, and those assumptions are within the yellow. And that's increasing the property tax of the assessed value 1% every single year, plus adding an additional 2% for the new construction. And we believe that this is a much more realistic approach, but I wanted to give you both sides because if new construction yields, then we wanted you to have both. And at the next council meeting, I will not be present, but there will be a continued journey update at that time on essentially having, bringing forward some with the
additional, I want to just go back. The one thing that we wanted to come back to at the next meeting was how we pulled the information for the levy, and there's a flyer that you can have, did you get the flyer?
Yes.
So you'll see on the flyer, the informational flyer that went out to the community and what the community needs were posted, was $200,000 would go to park debt, $100,000 would go to SRO, and $30,000 would go to IT improvements. We want to talk to you at the next meeting on, do you want to honor that ratio? Do you want to do something else? Because right now, when you look at this 1%, and we're looking at what our debt is, the debt for the park is, in 2017, was 230, or essentially basically 230 this time. So then we populate then what's the next priority, which was SRO, and then what's after that is IT. So IT is not receiving $30,000 at this time. And so we just want to check base, because if you want to go through kind of what we said to the community, we can do that. And that's why we're coming back partially for this information, and we'll come back to the meeting on the next 18th. And it could be where you start to talk about how you want to prioritize those dollars within that band of those three items. You might want to wait until after we give you the budget as well. You know, but there's going to be a couple of options that you can look at. But ultimately, it's a council decision, not a staff decision.
Questions?
Could you go to the other slide again, please?
This one?
No. That slide?
Hate to bring this up, but I think our assessments are going to be coming out fairly soon, because I spoke to someone in Kirkland that just got their assessment, and it went up $210,000 in 1 year. So that's kind of a shocker, and I just thought I would share that. Thank you.
Anyone else have any questions?
Great.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the updated info. We do not have any presentations or public hearings this evening, so we'll move on to new business. Our first item is Agenda Bill 18-52, Contract with Parametrics for the Wastewater Treatment Plant Capital Improvement Plan Update, for discussion only. Ms. Grindel.
So Parametrics isn't going to be looking at the entire city. they are going to, we have identified trunk lines, manholes, and lift stations that they'll look at, and those are the ones that are going to be greatly impacted by growth. So there's a couple legs that are up by the North Urban Growth Area that would be impacted by growth, and then there's some in the south part of the city, one that goes along Big Rock Road, that would be impacted. So those are some of the ones that they're going to analyze and kind of model to make sure that what we're adding to the system, it can handle. And that goes into the collection system evaluation. There's going to be a general facility charge analysis, similar to what we just did with the storm plan, what we did with the transportation plan, and then how we updated the park impact fee. So it's going to be a similar methodology. It's not a rate study, not yet, that's coming. And then another key task is going to be the capital improvement plan. This planning effort is going to produce a project list, again, similar to what we did with the transportation plan update and the storm plan update. This is a really nice flow process diagram of Duval, specifically wastewater treatment plant that Alan has made for us. So it's just a really nice visual. I hope you guys like it. And then the project goals. It's really going back to four to ensure the city stays in compliance and protects the environment, because we have an NPDES permit from that is at our treatment plant that we have to comply with, and we all care about the environment. Provide a roadmap for future needs that encompasses the growth and how we're growing and that we can handle it. Provide a plan to ensure that everything's properly funded. That's kind of what this whole plan is about. That's why we chose to call it a capital improvement plan. And to evaluate improvement costs, providing splits between existing and future connections.
Does anyone have any questions for Ms. Grindel this evening? Great. Seeing none, thank you. Oh, yes, you.
Sorry, I forgot to mention. I emailed everyone earlier an updated budget. Because we broke out a task from the original scope of work, we didn't update all the task allocations and everything. So this is an updated budget. It didn't change the project cost. It just reallocated money and properly titled the tasks. So I just wanted to make sure you guys knew what that was.
Councilmember Reddington.
I think this would be more directed for Alan, if you have one. Just a couple quick things. One of the big things we're working on as a city is looking at growth and the impacts and kind of our infrastructure and handle it. So that's really what this is about in my mind.
Yeah, the public works staff is basically trying to look ahead and make sure that you're thinking ahead and that you're getting your finances in place. And so Parametrics is going to, do more technical work, figure out, we'll actually computer model your sewer system, the way we can identify any capacity issues, so we can make sure that as growth happens, that you're looking ahead and making sure if corrections or changes need to be made to your sewer system or to the treatment plant, you're looking ahead, you've got a telescope out, you're going to be able to make sure that you can have time to do those, and of course have funding in place to do those. You don't want to be caught short on any of those issues.
When I look at our zoning map and how our wastewater system overlays it, residential seems like it's a little bit easier to calculate, a little tougher for light industrial. Is there a way to, I realize some industry provides a lot more waste than others. Do you have a way to measure that? We never know exactly what kind of industries might be interested in moving to Duval and how those might impact our system.
Right. So, good question. We have to use sort of a conservative approach there. Like you said, we don't know exactly what's coming in. Some of the industries do have a heavy water usage. We don't want to use the extreme case. We don't want to use the light case. We're going to be using an approximation of water usage, depending pretty much on square footage of the commercial properties that are available.
The last question I had, the contract just looks very complete, so I think we're going to get a good picture. But one of the things I always get concerned about is what are the new regulations that we may not be aware of that can impact our cost or how we have to go back and upgrade our system. Do you also take a look at any new legislation that's being looked at in the state of Washington, environmental regulations at the federal level that potentially would have a greater impact on the city of Duval that, we're going to have to take into consideration as well?
Yes, per metrics, we, you know, this is our specialty, wastewater and wastewater treatment, so we try and stay updated and know what's coming down the path. We're currently working with the city on evaluating human health standards, for instance. The rivers are now ecology on the state level. We're not just looking at the impact to the critters, we'll call them, in the rivers and in the estuaries. We're also looking at, where this has come down from the state, is the impacts of, in the extreme cases, what we looked at, if someone is taking fish out of the river and eating it pretty much every day, that has an impact, of course, on their health. We want to make sure that, at least at the state level, they're saying, let's look at that and see what limits that these treatment plants need. So we're already looking at that one for the city. There's also TMDL discussion. So what that is each of the water bodies in the state, they've been required to do what's called the total maximum daily load. That's what the TMDL stands for. And that looks at more of a holistic approach of what can the biology and the rivers and the water bodies, can they handle in order to, with the idea that we've got to protect the life of each of those water bodies. And so, I know the state, the state has already at least talked about ammonia in some of the cities in the southern border with Duval. And it's something that's always developing. Certain standards don't seem to get relaxed, but it's tougher. One thing definitely in your favor here in Duval is when we put in the treatment plant in 2005, you weren't looking at the standards at that time. You put on a treatment plant that is well above the standards that you have to reach. The MVR system, the membrane system that you have right now, produces a very high quality water, much, much better than you're required to do. It also allows you to do reuse if that comes down the line. If you have new developments coming in, that golf courses, things like that's real popular, where you can take some of your wastewater, putting it in the river, you can actually use it for beneficial use. Have irrigated golf course, irrigated some commercial properties. So you're able to do that also.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you, so.
Could you repeat your last statement about the shift in scope and?
Yes. So originally we brought under the emergency declaration, we broke out a task for a capacity analysis, mostly on the treatment plan. So what had happened was is we had seven tasks, they were just ordered differently. And so one, we actually removed one that was, it was called asset management. We removed that task. And so now we have the sewer GFC, which was previously, it was called rate study. We didn't want to confuse anybody, so we called it what it was. So it was mostly just in descriptions of tasking, and then we made sure that we have the additional item as directed, so that's kind of like the reserve fund. Like if you need it, that's what that task 7 is. It's there just.
Any last questions? Great, thank you so much. Moving on, we have Agenda Bill 18-53, an ordinance amending ordinance number 1200, Complete Streets Policy, for discussion only. Ms. Riddell.
So this is a really, all this really is we had an ordinance back in, I think it was 2016, that was adopted for Complete Streets, which allowed us to go for grant funding. And have a more holistic approach to how we get through and how we plan all of our transportation networks. And really all this is to make us more competitive. Alana's the one that mostly does this, so I'm kind of talking for her. But it's revised terminology of the already adopted ordinance. So all it's doing is adding language to make us more competitive for a nomination. Because you have to have a nomination in order to get certain grant fundings. So that's kind of what we had Transpo come and help us do as well. I hope that makes sense.
Any questions? Are you ready to move this on to for approval at the next council meeting? All right, we'll do that. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is Agenda Bill 18-54, an ordinance for our business license code update. It's discussion only. Ms. Wyckoff.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Jody Wyckoff, City Clerk. I'm going to read a little bit from my staff report for the public benefit. This is the staff report that was in your committee of the whole packet at the August 7th meeting. So in the 2017 sessions, the state legislators passed Engrossed House Bill 2005, which required three actions by cities with business licenses and local B&O taxes. One of them was to required cities with business licenses to establish a work group and create a model business license with license threshold by July of this year. That has been completed. The other is also the second half of that is that they must be adopted and in place for January 1, 2019. The second item is to require all cities with business licenses to administer their licenses through a state's business licensing system or file local. Duval's been a partner with BLS since 2006, so we can check that off of our list of things to do. Third is to establish a task force on local B&O tax service apportionment to report to the legislator by October of 2018. Duval doesn't have a B&O tax, and this is a work group that we're not involved in at this time. So at this point in time, what we have done is we have taken our current code and we have, I believe I included a strike and delete version. No, I didn't. Sorry. Still working with the attorney on the strike and delete version of our code. Basically, what we have to do is we have to adopt the model language for the definition of engaging in business. Kind of don't have any leeway on that. That is a mandate from the state that every city must adopt this exact language, so we're good there. With the threshold exemption, basically the threshold cannot go under 2,000. This only applies to out-of-city businesses. So if you have a business location in the city limits, you have to get a business license no matter what you earn in Duval. But if you have an out-of-city business, if you do not meet the minimum threshold, then you do not have to pay for a business license fee. So council has a couple of decisions to make. One is if they want to stick with the $2,000 minimum threshold or if they want to increase that threshold. The second is for those businesses that do not meet the threshold, the two choices are to either exempt them altogether, so they don't have to register, they don't have to pay, they don't have to do anything. The other option is to require them to do a registration only. They still don't pay the fee, but they notify us that they're in town doing business. So those are the two options that council has before them. And based on your direction, I will be bringing back an ordinance with those code amendments in the next few meetings for adoption. This does have to be adopted because we are a BLS partner. We have to adopt it no later than October 16th because they require 75 days by state mandate for us to notify them of the changes for January 1.
Any questions? Councilmember Rudnicki and then Councilmember McHenry.
So I was just wondering, what would the benefit be for those who just registered only for our city?
I don't know that there's necessarily a benefit, except to just notify us that they are in town doing business. We will not be getting any revenue from those businesses as far as business license fees. So it would just be to notify us that they're in town doing business.
And the second question was just discussed earlier with you. We still don't quite know how we would manage getting or understanding or knowing if they should be paying that fee for whoever is doing $2,000.
Right. So starting in January, the BLS system will be programmed. It's not programmed this way right now, but starting January 19, my understanding is that when you're applying for a license and you're an out-of-city business, it will require you to fill in what your gross revenues within each individual city is. And then if you, once we notify them, you want to hit, you know, 2,000 or whatever you choose, it will require them to apply for a license within that. But if they don't hit that threshold, then they don't have to pay the fee. And as far as I can tell, it's basically an honor system kind of thing at this point. I've asked a couple of times through the different webinars I've attended, like who's responsible for making sure that they're being honest, and there's really not a good answer at this point. Yes, there is definitely a potential for revenue loss in this. At this point, we don't know what that looks like. If you were to look at exactly what we, like if every single out-of-city business never made more than $2,000, or they said that they didn't make more than $2,000, that's almost half of our business licenses right now are out-of-city. So we could lose half of our revenue, although I don't see that happening necessarily. It's just that is the that's the high end of the projections of what could happen.
So I was just going to say that, you know, either way, I was curious if there was a cost to us in terms of staff time, or is it all managed on the system?
As far as
so if we went with licensing them versus requiring doing the registration only. Is that a difference on our end at all?
A little bit. I get notified by the state whenever somebody registers for a business license. So if they're out of city businesses, I really just make sure it's a legal activity, and then I don't have to run it through building or planning or anything like that for approval. So I'm able to approve those kind of right away. So I don't think that would necessarily increase what I already do. And obviously if they're exempt and we just say you don't have to register at all, then it might actually decrease a little bit my staff time.
I just wanted to add one more thing, and it's not really a question, but it's just, I guess in my head I'd lean toward the registration, and the only thing I like about it really is that it, in a way, might foster awareness of as they reach that threshold that, oh, I need to do this now. So it kind of gets them in the habit of what they should be doing when they hit that point. But that's all I'm saying.
And this is statewide. So I can't remember exactly what the year is, but it's like 2024 or something. Every city in the state will either be using File Local or BLS for their licensing. And the whole point is to streamline the licensing and the tax process for business owners. And then the only other thing you guys need to talk about is the threshold.
Does anybody have any feedback on the threshold? Mayor Bertemeyer.
Keeping it at 2,000 sounds good.
I'll just go down the line, I guess, here. Councilmember Remington?
No, yes.
Only or just flat out exempt. Those are the two options that we can choose from.
I like the idea of registering for something.
Councilmember Bernicke?
And what about the registry members? So I think we've got clear consensus, and now that council spoke, what I like about the registration is that while you might have a business coming in that's doing less than that 2,000 threshold, it might help us also track those that are doing door-to-door without solicitor licenses, and we might be able to make sure that more of those companies are properly licensed in the city. And then if somebody does call a complaint, we'll at least have some knowledge of the business doing business in the city. So I can see it, you know, being a little bit cumbersome, but yet no longer hopefully helping us. So thank you for that and that clear consensus. So Ryan, we have that for the next steps. All right, thank you. Under unfinished business tonight, we have Agenda Bill 18-51, Adopt Ordinance Amending Chapter 4.12.030 of the Duval Municipal Code, Sick Leave, Providing for Severability and Establishing an Effective Date. This is up for decision. Do we have a motion this evening? Discussion, Ms. Vaughn?
I just wanted to briefly say this is just to get us compliant with, you know, the new law that went into effect. Pretty much sums it up. Are there any questions?
Right, seeing none, we have a motion on the floor. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Motion passes. Thank you. And with that, we do not have an executive session. And so we have a motion to adjourn at 7:50 p.m.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye.